today for all that you have released. We thank you that today is an echo of what you've already stated, that it has already happened. We're simply walking into what you have done. We thank you that we are ready, we're prepared for the exercise of your Holy Spirit in our midst. We thank you again for the angels who are present today that you've assigned to be here with us. We thank you that our hearts are open to you. And we thank you that we will all grow together. I thank you, Lord, you will speak to my heart and my life, my situations. As I minister, you will minister also to everyone individually what they need. They will hear what they need to hear. They will sense what they need to sense. They will see what they need to see. We thank you, God, that what you have already set in motion will happen today. Nothing can hold you back. Nothing stands in the way of what you have for us today. And we praise you for that today. We honor you for that today. We thank you for what you're releasing in our midst today. In Jesus' name, amen. Let everybody say amen. 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 Good to see you. Thank you so much for being here and worship with us. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. I'm going to get right into the word today. Hello, Periscope. Please invite your friends and your loved ones to be with us. Hey, little one, how are you? Good. How's your arm? Your arm is good? She don't show me. Okay. Good, good. Thank you, Lord. We're going to get right into today's message. I'm continuing to deal with strongholds and what they are about, how they work. I'm focusing more on now what to do to pull them down, right? Not so much identifying them. I'm going to identify some, but I'm going to focus mostly on what to do to pull them down. And I'm talking about how to do what God wants me to do, right? Because there are some things God wants me to do. He wants me to do it. I need to know how to do it, right? And so I'm going to focus on that. How do I pull down the stronghold? They do come down. Amen? The giants do fall. How and what do I do? Okay? So first, let's look at what does God want me to do? And that's in Ephesians chapter 4. Those who watch it on Periscope, that first scripture is Ephesians chapter 4. And beginning with verse number 22 and verse 23. Ephesians 4. 22 and 23. If you would go there, Ephesians chapter 4, and I'm looking at the New American Standard Version of the Bible, but you may have another version to work with. People talk about the different versions. You ought to know that people work to put things together, right? And if you don't know the Greek and the Hebrew very well, you're kind of dependent on translation. Now what I do, I look at different translations. I do know that there are problems with this one, problems with that one. One of the major concerns that people have had with the version has been the NIV. You've seen some of the issues with the NIV. Some verses actually were left out. But they people have issues with everything. King James, who commissioned the King James Bible, was living a homosexual lifestyle, right? So they say, the word of God is still true. NIV, NIV. Whoever touches this is imperfect anyway. You got it? So I compare the different ones. I like New Living Translation because it makes it easier for me in the language I use today. But that doesn't mean that it is better than this or better than that, depending on how they apply what they understand the word to mean. But today we're going to be using this version, and someplace else I might use another one. But read the Word of God, amen? Get into it. If you have a version that doesn't make sense to you, there's probably one that will. The Living Bible, the Good News, the Message. You have all of those translations. You also have the New King James Version that takes out the these and the thous and stuff like that, but it keeps the poetic in there. You ready? Ephesians chapter 4. Let's get right into it. Father, I thank you. But what you're releasing today in Jesus' name. Yes. Ephesians 4, 22 and 23. That in reference to your former manner of life. Does anybody have a former manner of life?
Yes.
Oh, I know I do. It will scare you if you knew what my former manner of life was. Amen? It really would. But we lay aside the old self, right?
Yes.
Which is being corrupted in accordance with the lust of deceit. And what must happen? You must be what? Renewed where? In the spirit of your mind. Did you get it? So I got to lay aside that. And then what does God want me to do? To be
renewed
where?
In your mind.
In my mind. So I got to be transformed in my mind. So we're going to talk about how to pull down the strongholds. Let me review real quick. Let me see if my... Okay, you guys got to help me there in the back. Okay, let's click to the first slide. How to do it. And this is just a review. You're going to fill that in. Number two, you're going to fill it in. We have to learn to do what?
Listen.
You remember we talked about that? Listen, listen. I need to learn how to listen to God, right? And then the next slide, please. Oh, you put all that together, okay? I need to understand, and I also need to do what? Obey. So you remember that we talked about I need to listen to God. What is God saying? I need to understand what he's saying. And then what is the next thing I need to do? I need to obey it. Next slide. And how do I put my will? I got to put my will into action. I need to want what God wants for me. So it's not just talking about me wanting something. I need to want what God wants for me, right?
Yeah.
What does God want for you? So I want to put my will in action. I have to want what God wants for me. And then I need to decide. And you remember we talked about that word decide has to do with killing something? Decide, homicide, suicide, infesticide, germicide, spermicide, all of that. I learned a new one this week, ghettocide. Yes, there's a new term. I was in the library the other day, and I walked past a book called ghettocide. That is the destruction that happens, and mostly to black men, being piled up in death as a result of their experience in the ghetto, being shot by somebody as part of a drive-by gang initiation. There's a mark on your back. And they're piling up, they're stacking up, and we are being knocked out. There's a ghetto side, you're in the ghetto, stray bullet, that type of thing. You're involved, you're sagging, you're bagging, you're doing that kind of thing, and somebody runs up on you and starts shooting at you. Ghetto side, killed as a result of what's going on in your community. You're not literally in Iraq, you're in Chicago, or you know when they talk about it? Chicago. How many people were killed and shot in Chicago in one weekend? I thank God mama got me out of there, amen? Because I still remember that I could go to the corner grocery store and my older brother could not because they were recruiting him. When he would go, they would jump on me. I was little, they weren't recruiting me yet, right? Very well organized, going back there to witness on the street, like we go just knocking on doors. No, no, you had to get permission and they would tell you use this street or else. Are you following me? And at this time, get off the street because, out of the respect for the church. You know what I'm saying? Church people, you go down this way. If you're going to school and you're not banging, use this street only. Are you following? They're very well organized. Now, drugs mess it up and they start, a lot of innocent people get hurt. But get outside, slaying, stacking up the bodies and stuff. So what we're talking about, in order to pull down the stronghold, I need to listen, right? I need to understand. I need to obey what God is telling me to do. I need to want what God wants. Some people don't want what God wants. So I need to want what God wants, and I need to decide, mean I kill off the opposition. You got it? Did you get that? Okay, so what point are we on? We're ready for number four? I know it looks like a long lesson. I'm going to try to go through it fast, right? Number four, are you there with me? Yes, okay. Strongholds are the what, everybody? Lies. Click the next one, please. Strongholds are the what?
Lies.
They are the what?
Lies.
Lies of the, is the devil a liar?
Yes.
Strongholds are the what?
Lies
of the enemy. And where are they? They are hidden inside of the what?
Human
mind, waiting for us to agree or disagree, to approve of them. So there are lies that have been planted in my life and in my mind, and the devil knows they are set to go off. When certain experiences happen, they trigger these things. There's a trip wire in life.
And when I trip over that thing, that lie clicks in. And I approve of that. I accept it. And the stronghold is there. It's already implanted in your life and in your heart. You get it? You get it? You get it through your messages. You get it through your movies. You get it through TV. You get it through radio. They are pushing lies all the time. And the devil is waiting for you to agree with it or approve them. Oh, if I had time, I would talk about how that works. Amen? But just watch a movie. And whenever they're doing something, like somebody's having an affair with somebody, they have special music when you're having an affair. They don't have special music when the husband and wife are together. They just have them together, just use it. But no, you're doing something wrong. You're special music, I mean, just the most glorious music. And it plants that lie in your mind, and you start agreeing with that. Oh, yeah, watch it. And watch the music that they have when the husband and wife are together. Watch how they present a regular family. And then watch how they present a family that God is not blessing. That family of people, oh, they're the most wonderful. And then the Christian family, they're presented another way, planting a mind. The lie, rather, inside of the mind. You got it? Number five, I know we're moving rapidly, but this is not what I'm trying to get to. I want to say something in a minute. All right, you ready? Okay, number five, strongholds are negative. They are rigid. Do I have a number five? Yes. Negative, they are rigid. They are what? Mental structures that prevent me from hearing, seeing, or perceiving God. So something is going on to keep you from even hearing what God has to say. Something is taking place. So God is trying to say one thing to you. You don't even hear it. You don't even understand it. You're not happening. It's not happening in your mind. So strongholds are there. They're negative. But God is positive. They are negative, they are rigid, and they're structures that prevent me from hearing, seeing, or perceiving God. You got it? They block or they blind you. Are you still there with me? Okay, let's start to apply it. What do strongholds do to me? They block my perception. You got it? Here's another way of saying it. Listen, strongholds, I'm not there yet. Strongholds modify my behavior. Strongholds, I'm in the behavior modification. So I tell you, I get a kid and they're behaving one way. I begin to study that kid and figure out how to modify their behavior. And I do it in a way that the kid is not even aware that I begin to shape their behavior by the things I do, even at an antecedent or as a consequence. You know, I do the ABC and the B is in the middle. I don't worry about the behavior. I concentrate on what happens before the behavior, what happens after the behavior. The kid is just concerned about the behavior, but if I can modify what happens before, I can affect your behavior. The stronghold is there to modify your behavior. Are you getting it? To mold the way you think. Listen, so you will not be aware of what's going to happen in the future. So the kid is used to acting a certain way. They're planning to misbehave. I modify what's going to happen in front or modify what's going to happen in the end, and they can't behave the same way because they're not going to get the same reward. Let me give you an example. Are y'all still there? Yeah. Moses. You remember the guy Moses?
Yes.
Yeah, in the Bible. Moses, listen, Moses had a problem with anger. Yeah, he understood that he was supposed to do something great for God. The man messed up. What did he do? He killed him. Did he do it? Yeah, he did. He killed him and he buried him. Now, how bad can you be? Anybody ever made? No, don't you start confessing here now. We got to turn you in. Don't you start confessing, Pastor. I got body stacked. No, you don't. You don't do that. Amen. But Moses killed the man. Right? And he ran for 40, listen, and didn't deal with the anger. Because when he came back and God started teaching him, God told him to talk to the rock. God told him to speak to a rock. And you remember the people made him mad. Anybody ever made you mad? We have a word for it. It say, you blinked me off. And y'all know the word?
Yes.
Oh, you filled in the blank, didn't you? We got a word for it. The people blinked him off. And what did he do to the rock? Moses started beating the rock. And what did God do? God said, because you've acted out of anger, you cannot go into your future in the way I designed it for you. Strongholds come along to modify my behavior and to stop me from going into the future God has for me. Are you getting that? My behavior is modified. It molds the way I think, right? And it stops my progress. You got it? So when there's no progress, there's a stronghold at work. There's a stronghold over this house that must be broken in the name of Jesus. Come on, if I had some prayer warriors, we'll pull it down, amen? But we're not able to do it because we're struggling so much individually with our own strongholds. We cannot unite together and pull down the one here. So if I can get you to get that one pulled down in your life, then you can unite with all of us and we'll snatch this one down in the name of Jesus. Are you getting that? Oh yeah, they're strongholds. They're strongholds, and they must change in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Come on, let's keep working. Are y'all still here?
Yes.
All right. Listen, strongholds are built when I play with, listen, or approve of the suggestions, the influences, and thoughts of the enemy. You can't play with him, right? The suggestions, the influences, the thoughts of the enemy. It becomes a mindset or a thought pattern that becomes a stronghold, and eventually the stronghold would lead to a reprobate mind. You know, there's some people in life today, the Bible talks about, they're behaving in a way that God would just give them a reprobate mind. Yeah, and they would do things that are inconvenient. You know what scripture I'm talking about. And they're making it a lifestyle. They say, this is my lifestyle. Ah, man. that's not my subject today. Anyway, but you can end up there, but you don't start there. You start on the other end. You start on the other end, playing with the suggestion, agreeing with the suggestion, being molded in that way. And it becomes a thought pattern, and then you end up with a reprobate mind. That's the way your mind works. And if the power of God doesn't come along and tear all of that stuff down, every time you get on the freeway, you get off at the same stop. The thoughts will create a habit. The habit will produce conduct. Conduct produces character. Character is who I am. Character produces destiny. Did you all hear that?
Yes.
I know I'm moving fast today. I'm getting ready to slow down and start preaching here in just a moment. You got it? Huh? So listen, my thoughts, create a habit. My habit creates my conduct. My conduct creates the character. My character produces my destiny, right? Which means, listen, that my wrong thoughts can modify my destiny.
All right.
Did you all hear that? My thoughts can divert me from my destiny. So I want to pull down the strongholds. Why? Because my wrong thinking will have me end up in the wrong place.
Yes.
I was headed for Santa Monica, and I keep ending up in Long Beach. Well, how did that happen? Because I only knew how to go to Long Beach. Are you getting that? Come on, you got it?
Yes.
Okay, so do you know anybody here willing to agree with me that strongholds are a problem?
Yes.
Come on, if they're a problem, let me hear you say amen.
Amen.
Okay, you understand that. So let's work on the solution. We already know we got a problem. Wait a minute. You're not convinced you got a problem?
Yeah.
Oh, let me put the news balloon up. You just as crazy as you can be without the power of God. You just don't know what you're capable of doing. You got all of that junk inside of you. You got your daddy's mess in you, your mama's mess, Uncle Crazy Joe's mess on the inside of you, and in the right conditions, and to trip that wire, and you'll be laying bodies all over the place.
Right.
Are you hearing me today?
Yes.
Come on, are you hearing me today?
Yes.
Okay, so are you convinced that there are strongholds in people's lives today?
Yes.
Yes or no? Are you convinced that you want to be free from the stronghold?
Yes.
Amen, amen. Make sure he has an outline. You want to be convinced that you have strongholds? You want to be getting rid of them? So now let's talk about how to get rid of the stronghold. You ready?
Yeah.
Come on, because I don't need to convince you anymore. You know you got it, right?
Right?
Come on, you know you got it. So now I want to get rid of it in Jesus' name. Amen?
Amen?
Amen, amen. So we know we need to listen. We know we need to understand. We know we need to obey. We need to put into action our will. I need to want what God wants for me, right? I need to kill off the opposition, right?
Yeah.
I need to know that the strongholds are the lie of the enemy. I need to know it prevents me from hearing or seeing God. And now I need to know what to do about it, right?
Yes.
Are you there with me?
Yes.
Okay, so let's talk about the how-to part. the how to get rid of the stronghold in Jesus' name. Are you ready? Come on, I'm asking, are you ready? Are you there?
Yes.
Okay. Point number six on our outline. We're moving rapidly. Point number six on our outline. We're moving rapidly. How to be free of the stronghold. You ready? I need to what? Acknowledge the thought. Amen. Did you hear that? Amen. So when I'm thinking wrong, I need to do what? Acknowledge the thought. You cannot change what you do not acknowledge. You must acknowledge your thought. I must be aware that the thought is present. I must acknowledge the condition. The thought is present. I must acknowledge the thought. What are some of the two strongholds? Acknowledge your thought. Do you know some people have fear of men? Amen. They're worried about their reputation. They're worried about what people will think about them. You can't worship because I'm worried about what people will think about me. I can't say amen because I'm worried. I can't lift my hands because I'm worried. I'm worried about. So I need to acknowledge the thoughts that I am worried. Amen. I can't change it unless I acknowledge it. Some people have issues with money. Amen. You need to know if you have a money problem. Some of us are too stingy. Amen. And some of us are crazy with our money. We don't respect it on the other side. Some people get offended when it comes to offering time. And I need to acknowledge that I have a problem with my giving. Amen?
Amen.
Come on, say amen.
Amen.
Some people have problems in their sexual area. They are immoral. And they have immoral thoughts. Amen. And they have immorality that goes after women. They have immorality that goes after men. They have, who was that to say? Some women attach romance to their mess. Some men just in mess. You know what I'm saying? But some people don't agree with it because it's a romantic thing going on, an emotional connection, but it's still wrong. You need to acknowledge the thought. My mind is in the wrong place, and I can't get God to change it until I'm willing to acknowledge that that is wrong.
Amen.
Come on, stay in the room with me. Stay in the room. I need to what?
Acknowledge
the thought. Some people have an issue with poverty. Come on, let's talk about it. Poverty is a habit. Come on, poverty is a habit. Bad habits. Come on, poverty is also a culture. There are some people who are in the culture of not moving ahead in life, and they're complaining about people having more. I don't want to take what they have. I want to learn how to make what they did. Amen. I want to learn how to invent so I can have what I want to have and be a blessing to other people. Man, I meet people every week who need to be a blessing. I know somebody right now. My wife and I were talking about it and said, man, God, if we had more, we'd be able to do this for them and that for them and that. We're doing everything we can. But imagine if we had more of what we'd be able to do for people. Poverty is a habit for some people. Poverty is a cultural thing. You ever met people with a ghetto mentality? I mean, just low, don't know what to do, don't know how to advance, they're not interested in learning how to move ahead. But poverty is also a spirit. Are you hearing me? And poverty is also a mindset. So when you're dealing with somebody with poverty, you got to figure out, is it a habit? You got a habit, you don't know what to do with money. I can teach you what to do with money. Amen. If you're not offended by it, I can teach you how to honor God with 10%, how to save some money, how not to spend all of your money buying lunch every day and flushing it down the toilet at the end of the day. Amen. Amen. You can get ahead in life if you didn't give Starbucks all of your money. Imagine paying all of that money for a cup of coffee. And then it's a culture, it's a mentality where you're not moving ahead in life, but you're spending more money on Christmas than you are spending putting in a savings account.
That's right.
Oh man, you're going into debt for Santa Claus, I ain't never met it. Are you hearing me?
Right.
It's also a spirit that's on you and a mindset, amen? Rebellion is a stronghold. Anybody know about that? Oh man, you tell me what to do and I'll roll up against you. I'm not doing it if you tell me what to do it. Oh no, that's a stronghold, amen. So nobody can teach you, nobody can train you, nobody can help you. Unbelief is a stronghold. Listen, unbelief is the greatest insult to God. Because unbelief says to God, God, you can't do that. God said, I bless you. I don't believe it. God is like, are you telling me I raised the dead? And how dare you tell me that I can't bless you if I intend to bless you? I can turn around what is impossible and make it happen right in your face. Unbelief is an insult to God, and unbelief is a stronghold. Here's another one. Fear is a stronghold. Anybody know what it's like to be afraid?
Yes.
Amen. Know what it's like. God will help you. By the way, we're going to be worshiping in a minute. The spirit of revelation is here available today. Be sensitive. God is going to give you insight. He's going to show you things about yourself that can be changed today in Jesus' name. But he will help you with your fear. Help you with your fear. One of the things I've been dealing with God as I get older, I don't like the idea of dying. I don't mind going on with life. I just don't like how it stops. Anybody know what I'm talking about? You're just rolling on. I've been talking to God about it. And he was just telling me today as we're worshiping. He said, the issue is you got to know that I will never leave you nor forsake you. Amen. And once you know that, then even the Bible said death cannot separate me from the love of God. And once I got grounded in that, then I can just keep on walking with God. And even if I got to lay down, I still belong to him. Are you hearing me? Yeah. Before I pull down the stronghold, I need to acknowledge that the stronghold is working in my life. Amen. Come on, we're going to practice here. We're going to practice. Could you get a neighbor? Come on, stand up real quick. Get one neighbor real quick. You can stand up in church. Come on, stand up and get one neighbor real quick. Maybe somebody you didn't come in with. Come on, move quickly. Come on, saints, you're moving too slow. Get one neighbor and say, I want. Come on, you're moving too slow. I want. Come on, the strongholds broken in my life. And I will acknowledge today. Come on, in the name of Jesus. That the stronghold will be broken. Then look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, come on, y'all move too slow. Is there a stronghold in your life that you need to acknowledge? And if you got one today, acknowledge it today in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Come on, be seated in Jesus' name. Come on, move to the next one. Which one are we on? Which one are we on? Number 7. Are you ready? So number 6, I need to what? Acknowledge the thought. Number 7, I need to repent of the thought. Did you get that?
Yes.
I need to do what?
Repent.
Come on, I'm talking about how to pull it down. I need to do what?
Repent.
So I need to know I had that thought. Amen.
Yes.
I had that thought. The Bible talks about how if a man looks at a woman and does what? Lust after her. What has happened? He has already... Right. We were talking about a man the other day. He was walking across the street. Almost didn't make it across the street. He was walking like this. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Yeah, he wasn't just directing traffic. Now he went someplace else and almost didn't make it across the street. So if you're thinking like that, you need to do what? Acknowledge the thought, and then you need to, come on, repent of the thought. So if it's immorality, do what? Repent. If it's fear, do what? Come on, if it's poverty, do what? Repent. Don't play with the thought.
Yes.
Acknowledge the thought. I need to repent of the thought. I'm going to tell you why you can't play with it in just a moment, but I want you to agree to the fact I got to acknowledge the thought. I got to acknowledge the thought. One of my friends helped me in life. He said, man, when you got thoughts like that, listen. This is not in my notes. I'm giving this to you free. When you got thoughts like that, consider them God's calling card that you need him. So if you find yourself walking across the street and you're about to run into a wall over there, consider God saying, you need me. Not that, you need me. You're not hearing me today. So don't play with the thoughts of pornography, amen? Come on, saints, don't play with the thoughts of immorality, amen? Don't play with the thoughts of careless spending. Are you hearing me? Don't waste your money. Don't play with the thought of lying. Cheating, self-destruction. Somebody say, I need to repent. And when I repent, I change the way I think about that thing.
Right.
Are you hearing me today?
Yes.
Change the way you think about something. What you're thinking about doing may be blocking you in some area of life. Because remember, the strongholds come to modify your behavior. So you're thinking about that thing, it begins to modify your behavior, and you end up in another place. Are you here? Many of us know, listen, flies are attracted to decay. The nastier the smell, come on, the more flies will be attracted. Are y'all still in the room? Okay, y'all understand. My dog Charlie, it's the most interesting to me. I walk him, and you know Charlie likes to do one and two. He's not just a number one dog, he has one and two. But what's interesting to me, we can be walking, and Charlie can take care of his business, no flies around. You know what I'm saying? No flies around. And soon as he hits number two, all of a sudden, here come the flies. Yeah. Where were the flies before? They were hanging around, waiting for the smell of the garbage. So the enemy is watching you and polluting your mind with these thoughts. And as the thoughts are departed there, here comes the demonic activity that have been hanging in the air waiting for the deposit. Are you all listening to me? Yeah, and as time goes on, things get worse. Why? Because as people die off, their demons are not dying off. They're looking for places to go and hang out. Oh, you say, Pastor, there's nothing wrong with what I'm doing. Nobody is watching. They may be true in the physical realm, nobody watching, but that's not true in the spiritual realm. Somebody is always watching. The flies are hanging around. The nastier the smell, the more flies you're going to get. Did you hear me? Listen, so this is why I need to repent from the heart. Why? Because my repentance, listen, will unravel what the enemy has been using to hold me in bondage. Have you ever had something tied up, tangled up? Electrical cord, your computer wires, you had to unravel those things. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Everybody, thank God we're going wireless, amen. You don't even have to have it with your earplugs, amen. Thank God for Bluetooth, but long before Bluetooth, the enemy comes along. So when I'm thinking something that is no good, here come the flies. I'm judging my pastor. Here come the flies. I'm judging the president. Here come the flies. I'm judging my parents. Here come the flies. I'm judging my husband. I'm judging my wife. I'm judging my father. Here comes the flies. I need to be aware that I'm in judgment. And the Bible says, the way you judge, guess what? That's how you're going to be judged. Here comes the flies. I need to repent if I want the flies to leave. But Pastor, it's hard for me to repent. Are you ready for this?
Yes.
No problem. I understand. It's always hard to repent when you like what you're doing. Say that again, Pastor. I'll say it again, man. I'm going to just celebrate myself, amen, today. You got it. The reason why it's hard, because there's something about it that I like. Have you ever watched somebody, and they're talking about something they didn't want to do, and in the process of talking about it, they kind of smile. I didn't want to do it, but they're kind of laughing, because on the inside, I'm upset that I got caught, but I'm smiling because of something that I wanted to do. It's hard to repent when you're not willing to die to be right with God. Not willing to die to self. No, it's hard for me to repent. Are y'all hearing me today? Come on, if you get in that, say amen. Okay, so number one, I need to do what? When I have the thought that's ungodly, I need to what?
Acknowledge
I got that thought. And then I need to do what, everybody? Repent of the thought. Are you still with me?
Yes.
Come on, stay with me, Periscope. Number eight. It says here, any. Can you put that word down? It's not hard to write. Number eight, write it in. What does it say?
Any.
Unrepented thought can be used to build a what, everybody? Stronghold. Give no place to the devil. Right? So we need to tell people to repent. You can't do it in your own ability. But you're willing to change, amen? You ready? All right, some of them are ready, some of them are not. Periscope, I hope you're ready. Come on, stand up, grab a neighbor real quick. Come on, can you do it faster than you did last time? I'm going to ask you on each point anyway, so get ready. Come on, move to somebody you don't know. Come on, real quick. Come on, man, y'all move slow. You ready? You'll practice with your neighbor. Grab your neighbor's hand and say, neighbor. Come on, say, neighbor. I'm agreeing with God. But my thoughts are not right. I will repent. In Jesus' name, I ask you, Jesus, to remove from me, come on, any sin, any compromise, anything that is not like you, take it away. I want you in my life, Jesus. Come in now and be Lord of my life. Come on and remove anything that is not like you. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Come on, you may be seated. Let's keep rolling. Come on, you may be seated. Let's keep rolling. Are you getting it? I need to acknowledge the thought, amen. I need to acknowledge the thought. I need to repent of the thought. Are you ready for this? Any of the devil's thoughts that I hang on to can be used as building block, like Legos, spiritual Legos,
yes,
to get me messed up in my life. Are you with me?
Yeah.
Come on, let me know that you're here with me, because we got to dig into this thing today. You hear?
Yes.
Number nine. Oh, this is strong. You ready?
Yes.
Discipline and self-control.
Amen.
Discipline. I want to know how to pull it down. I need to acknowledge it, right?
Right.
I need to repent in the name of Jesus. And I need to have discipline. And what is the next word? Self. Control. Are you ready for this? Look up at me. Let me tell you something. This is the part God will not do for you. Did you hear me? This is the part. God will help you. Are you listening? When you want what He wants, God will help you.
Amen.
If you want what God wants, God will bring you to the place where you're able to be disciplined. When you give Him your will and you kill off the opposition, when you decide, God will help you. He will bring you to that place. But how do you exercise self-control? Thoughts are going through your head. Begin to speak something different than the thought. You can fight a thought with another thought. We've done it. Men, we try to help men dealing with addiction. And the urge for addiction comes along your body, your mind, and everything is lined up. You're headed to the store. And you want to know how we tell them to say anything other than what you used to say. I'd rather that you pray, amen. Pray the serenity prayer. But anything you say, because you begin to fight that thought with another thought. Start talking to yourself when the temptation comes. Start talking to yourself, I won't do it. Come on, I refuse to think about it. You're talking to yourself, right? I'm going to set my mind on the things above. Amen. Talk to yourself. I came out of drugs. I'm not going back. I'm not going to turn my mind over to those things. Talk to yourself. Rebuke that thought in the name of Jesus. Are you hearing me?
Yeah.
How do I maintain self-control? I talk to myself in Jesus' name. I tell self-pity, get out of here. I do the talking. The Holy Spirit provides the power. Are you listening to me?
Yeah.
Amen. So the urge comes for you to make a phone call that you know you shouldn't make. Come on, stay in the room. You know you shouldn't make the phone call. Amen. You got the phone right there. They told you to erase the number, but you really didn't erase the number. Anybody know what I'm talking about?
Right.
Amen. Somebody in here. Amen. Start talking to yourself. I'm not going to make the call. Are you hearing me? I acknowledge I got the thought. I repent of the thought. And then I tell myself, I'm not going to make the call. I'm going to call somebody else instead. Amen. Come on, you're watching TV, and here come the thought, here come that special music, huh? You're listening to your music and everything, and here comes your song, amen. And everything starts moving down the line. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Huh? Start talking to yourself. Say, self, turn the music on. Say, self, put something else on, amen. Say, self, drop that and put on classical or something, anything that's going to turn it around. If you don't want to worship, put on some kind of music different than that, amen. I will arise and talk to myself. Are you hearing me?
Yes.
Spirit of fear, in the name of Jesus, I command you to leave. Are you hearing me?
Amen.
Come on, grab a neighbor real quick. Can you jump up and move faster than you moved last time? Come on, real quick, find somebody else. Come on, come on, come on, come on. Man, the saints are getting too comfortable. Somebody needs to turn the heater off. They're getting too comfortable. Come on, grab another neighbor. Come on, stand up, move quick, 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 quick. Come on, quick. Are you ready? Come on, say neighbor.
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 We're going
to learn how to defeat the enemy today. Say neighbor. When the wrong thoughts come, acknowledge them. Repent to God. And start talking to yourself about what you want and not what the devil is trying to give you. Say immorality. I command you in the name of Jesus to leave my life, to leave my marriage, to leave my experiences, to leave my children alone in the name of Jesus. Poverty, I command you to go in the name of Jesus. I will use my money right. I will use my money right. I will honor God in the name of Jesus. Come on. Sickness, I command you to go in the name of Jesus. I will not bow to disease. I step up over disease. I am healed in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Come on. Learn how to do it. How to do it. Come on. How to do it. Move quickly. Move quickly. How to do it. How to do it. Are you getting this? I'm learning how to do what? Pull down the stronghold. I got to acknowledge that those are my thoughts. Amen.
Amen.
Number 10. Number 10 is another how to. Submit. Submit or take captive every thought.
That's right.
Submit or do what?
Take
captive every thought in the name of Jesus. I hear you. I hear you. I hear you. I hear you, babe. Could you set up the communion emblems right now? And I'm going to ask you, we're going to keep preaching and keep ministering. Yes, Periscope, stay with me. Listen, I'm going to ask you all to come around, pick up your communion emblems. We're going to minister some more. We're going to go into communion, and we're going to get this in our hearts and our spirit. I'm going to ask you to come by. Each of you, if you would, come by now and just pick that up. I'm not finishing the sermon. I'm just moving through. We're going for freedom today in Jesus' name. Amen. Come on, we're going for freedom in Jesus' name. So everybody from this side, if you would just come around and pick up your emblems and go sit down. Everything is prepared for you. And then that side. So let's begin on this side and start moving in the name of Jesus. Amen. Move in the name of Jesus. I'm acknowledging what's going on. I'm repenting. I'm repenting of the things that's not right in my life. I'm taking control over the things. God is not going to do it for me. And I'm getting ready to move to the next one. Come on, come on, come on. In Jesus' name, let the Lord do it. Yes, you can get it for your friend, your neighbor. I want it in place because we're going to get this thing changed today. Hallelujah. We're going to get it changed today in Jesus' name. Come on. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. In Jesus, I'm on this side. Come on, come on. Come on, come around. Get your emblems. Get it for your family. Come on, media. Get it, and we're going to move on. We're going to move on to number 4. You got it?
Yes.
Amen. You got it. Just hold on to it. Just hold on to it. We're going to receive the bread and the wine together here in just a moment. If you're there on Periscope, just get ready. You can get your bread and wine also and take communion with us in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Did we get everybody covered? Make sure I have one here. You make sure you have it there. Yes. In Jesus' name. Amen. We're on number what, everybody? Number 10, right? Number 10. How to take captive. How to submit. Are you there?
Yes.
Submit every what?
Every thought.
Or take captive every. You got to submit it. You got to capture it. You got to do what? Because thoughts are things.
Yes.
Thoughts are actually little packages of energy that have unzipped DNA on the inside of you,
right,
to be expressed on the outside of you. So your thoughts, and they express as words because they're designed to form something.
That's right.
You got to capture those thoughts and have Jesus check it out. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, what is the scripture? 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Are you there?
Yes.
For it says, though we do what? Sorry, Periscope. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 6. For though we do what? Walk in the flesh. Anybody in the flesh here today? Yes. We do not what? War according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare, what? Not carnal, but they are what? Mighty how? Come on, underline those two words. They're mighty how?
In God.
For doing what?
Pulling
down strongholds. And what are we able to do? Cast down what? Arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God. And what do we do? Bring every thought where? Into captivity to the obedience of Christ. And being ready to do what? Come on, you got to be ready to do what? Punish all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled. Can you underline that word captivity? Captivity. What does captivity mean? When you capture something, what does it mean? When somebody's captured your heart. Pastor, he captured my heart. Oh, you're in trouble now, girl. Because you cannot get away. Oh, that's what you're saying, isn't that right? He's captured your heart. What does it mean, captivity? What does it say? When you capture something, what have you done? Huh? You caught it, and who's in control now?
You are.
Yes, you are. So you cannot play with the thought. Because when you play with the thought, the enemy will put the train on the tracks. And the train will go on down the tracks. And before you know it, you're doing something, saying something, experiencing something that embarrasses you or your family or everybody who knows you. Now, y'all don't want to say amen.
All right.
I'll say that again. You don't have to put the train on the tracks. When you play with the thought, the enemy will put the train on the tracks. He already has a destination in mind. That's why you have to capture the thought. Who's now going to be in control? You are going to be in control. And you bring it and submit it to Christ. You got it?
Amen.
Here's the key. If you keep having the same thought in the same area, the thought won't go away. It will not go away until you are obedient in that area. Let me say that again. Here's the key. Example, you got thoughts in the area of your finances, right? You are thinking, I am not going to make it. You are thinking, I will lose my job and be homeless if I give as the Lord tells me to give. Those thoughts keep coming to your mind. When the thoughts come to your mind, you rebuke it in Jesus' name, right? Listen to this. You capture it and you punish it. You tell it not to come back. You close the door. You replace it with a godly thought. You become obedient in that area. Let me say it again. I repent of the problem, right? I capture the thought that will lead me the wrong way. And I punish the thought. How? By being obedient to God in the way God wants me to be obedient. For example, struggling with finances, I can't give. I repent before God. I acknowledge I got thoughts like that, right? I repent before God. I become disciplined in that. I repent for not returning my tithe. I tell God, I repent for not returning my tithe. The thought is not going away. Now what do I need to do? Capture the thought and punish it by being obedient in the area of my finances. You all didn't hear. You didn't hear. In the case of my giving, I am not free to give to God because I'm captured with the thoughts. I don't tithe. I don't give offering because I'm afraid. I'm afraid that God is not honest. I attack God with my thoughts that God cannot be trusted. Can God be trusted? Yes or no? I say yes, but my behavior says no. Are you all hearing me? So what do I have to do? I repent that I got the thought. I exercise discipline. And then I punish the thought by being obedient in the area of my finance. I become a cheerful giver.
Yes.
Y'all are not hearing me now. When I become a cheerful giver, after a while the devil has to stop messing with me in the area of my thoughts. Because that thing is settled. And when you resist the devil, what will he do? He will flee from you.
Right.
Are you all getting that? I got to learn how to punish that thing in Jesus' name. Amen?
Yes, amen.
Amen. Amen. You ready? Come on, run to your neighbor real quick. Run to your neighbor real quick. Last time. Come on. Run to your neighbor. Come on, y'all move too slow. You move too slow. Stand up, find a neighbor. Come on, stand up, find a neighbor. And say, I agree. Come on, in the name of Jesus. That where the enemy has been capturing me and planting the wrong thoughts in my life, I will capture those thoughts. I will submit unto Jesus. I will punish them by obeying God in that area. In the area of my finance, I will obey God. In the area of my sexuality, I will obey God. In the area of my love, I will obey God. Come on. In the area of my speaking, I will obey God. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Come back to your seats. Come back to your seats. Here's another one we don't talk about much in the church, but we ought to. It's there in the Bible. It's very clear. It's there in the Bible. Point number 12. Are you there? Here's another thing you can use to help you. You can learn how to pray in the Spirit. Do you see that?
Yes.
1 Corinthians chapter 14, 2 through 5. It's there in your Bible. What does it say? For one who does what? Speaks in a tongue, does not do what? Speak to men, but to who, everybody? Whoa, did you underline that in your Bible? For no one understands, but in the Spirit he does what? Speaks mystery, but the one who prophesies speaks to men for what? Edification. Are you still there?
Amen.
Exhortation and what?
Consolation.
One who speaks in a tongue does what, everybody?
Edifies.
Come on, are you there? He does what?
Edifies
himself. But the one who prophesies does what?
Edifies
the church. Now I wish that you all do what, everybody? That's what your Bible says. But even more that you would do what, everybody? Greater is the one who prophesies than one who speaks in tongues, unless, do you see that? Unless he interprets so that the church may receive what? Come on, when you're praying in tongues, are you speaking to men or are you speaking to God? According to the Bible, which one are you doing, men or to God? Come on, men or to God? Men are not understanding you speaking to God. It edifies you. It builds you up. Look at point number 13. Praying in tongues always affects us in positive ways. Because it gets past our reasoning, past our thoughts, beyond something we can conceive of doing, and launches us in to the things God has for us. It edifies us. It builds us up. Praying always in the Spirit, the Bible tells us in Ephesians. That's something we got to learn how to do. Amen? Now, everybody, would you get your communion cup? Stay with this periscope. Everybody get your communion cup. Band, you can come back and get ready. We're going to worship here. I'm going to give you another tool that's very powerful. We're going to use it, thank you, Lord, in 2017. We're going to use it in the new year. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. He washes away all sin and all misery. Amen. Amen, amen. We're going to celebrate God's goodness.
Amen.
We're going to celebrate his mercy. We're going to praise him. We're going to worship him. We're going to shout unto the Lord with the voice of triumph.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. I got you. I got you. That's all right. You're struggling today. I'm going to pull you right on into your destiny in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
So we're going to receive the bread here in just a moment. It represents the body of Christ. Thank you, Lord. And one of the reasons this is designed by God to take the issue of righteousness out of your hands and put it in God's hands in Jesus' name. Yes, man, you can get ready. It takes it out of your hands and puts it in whose hands?
God's
hands. Amen. His body, which was broken for you. Amen. His body, which was broken for you. We're going to receive today in Jesus' name. Does everyone have your communion elements today?
Amen.
We're going to receive it in Jesus' name. We're going to receive it in Jesus' name. We're going to thank it. We're going to make it part of our experience today. And we're going to make sure that we're going to step into all that God has for us. Amen. Amen and amen. So, Father, I thank you that Jesus died on the cross to give us what we could not get for ourselves. And as we get ready to celebrate who he is and what he has done for us, we thank you. We thank you that the burden is on you. We are here to simply cooperate with what you're all about and what you have given us in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's receive the bread together in Jesus' name. Stay with this periscope. I got one more point I want to share with you. Hallelujah. And then just below that, the grape juice that represents the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. That washes away all of my sin. Not just the future. Not just the present. Oh, not just the past. Not just the present, but also the future. That Jesus has celebrated the fact that his life puts us in a position of being the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. As we receive this today, we're receiving the freedom that comes with being a son or daughter of God. We can say now together, I'm going home to my Father. We're saying now together, I'm not going to stay outside. I'm coming in inside, and I'm going to party with him today in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's consume together and understand as we drink this wine, it represents the blood of Jesus that's washed every sin from our life. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Are you ready for the last point? And then we're going to worship together. We're going to worship together. I believe our praise team is going to come back and minister to us in just a moment. I just got this last point, band. You can just stay with me. And we're going to share that. We're at point number 14. A lot of points, but it didn't take us all day to get there, did it? Okay, you all are still here with me? Okay, amen.
Yes.
Amen. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Numbers 14. Are you there?
Yes.
Number 14 is that you want to engage in praise and worship. I have the scripture there for you. You want to write down the words praise and worship, or particularly the word praise, the word praise. And I want to talk about that just briefly. And then you remember how we've been practicing acknowledging, how we've been practicing repenting, how we've been practicing speaking to ourselves, right?
Yes, please.
We're going to practice praise and worship in Jesus' name. Amen. What is Isaiah 61, 1 through 3? What does it say? The what? Oh man, I got people who are ashamed of the Bible, sad they came to church, because I asked them, what does it say? Really? Really? After all of that preaching? After all of that preaching? That's what he said. Do it again. Let me hear y'all do that again. No, no, no. Do it like you did the first time. Do it like you did the first time. What does it say? Isaiah 61. 1 to 3, what does it say? The what?
The Spirit of the Lord.
Oh, wow, y'all getting better. Can you cross out the me and put your name in there?
Yeah.
Oh, my God. I know. You're the pastor. That applies to Jesus. Is Jesus in you?
Yes.
Has Jesus commissioned you?
Yes.
Amen. So the Spirit of the Lord is upon who today?
Yeah.
Come on. Because the Lord has done what?
Anointed.
Come on, are y'all with me? The Lord has done what?
Anointed
me to do what?
Bring
good news to who, everybody? Any afflicted that you know? He has sent me to do what?
Bind.
Come on, y'all, to do what?
Bind
up the brokenhearted. Send me to do what?
Proclaim.
Come on, proclaim liberty to who, everybody?
Captain.
And freedom to the prisoners. Number two, to proclaim what?
Favorable.
What is the favorable year of the Lord? Any year that you're speaking God's word, amen. And the day of vengeance of our God to comfort all who mourn. Are you there?
Yes.
To grant those who mourn in Zion, giving them a garland instead of ashes, right? The oil of what, everybody?
Gladness.
Come on, the oil of what, everybody?
Gladness
instead of mourning. And then we're going to put on what? The mantle. Come on. Come on, we're going to do what? The mantle of praise, so that instead of a spirit of fainting, so that we'll be called oaks of righteousness. Amen? So here's one of the things I'm going to do. I'm going to learn how to do what? Acknowledge when I got the wrong thought. Amen?
Yes.
I'm going to learn how to repent. Amen?
Yes.
Learn how to deal with self-control. All right? I'm going to learn how to deal with that. I'll learn how to pray in the Spirit. I will get those things involved. Amen? I will learn how to do that. Submit every thought. And I will learn how to praise God. I will put on the garment of praise. I will put on the garment of praise. When I feel like fainting, when I feel like mourning, I will learn how to praise God in spite of how I feel, in spite of what I see, in spite of what I'm hearing. I will learn how to party with God. I don't have to wait until 1 year is going out and another year going in and begin to reflect on what God has done for me the entire year. But I will be able to praise God any moment, any day, any time, and worship Him. Amen. You don't have to feel like it. Praise is a sacrifice. Amen. And I lift my hands as a sign of surrender today. Anybody ready to try it with me? Come on, stand with me again. Stand with me again. Okay, you're moving slow. You're moving slow. The word stand means to stand up. You're not required to do it, but I'm asking you to do it. And we lift our hands as a sign of surrender. Come on. Come on, as a sign of surrender. Come on, as a sign of surrender. Worship your Father. Come on, worship God. Come on, worship Him. I come before you as your child. Can you say that to God? I come before you as your child. I come before you as your child in the name of Jesus. Come on, in the name of Jesus. Come on, help me somebody. I repent in the name of Jesus. Come on, I acknowledge that I've been playing with thoughts that the enemy has sent to my life. I've been playing with fear and unbelief and judgment and self-pity. I repent in Jesus' name. Come on. Come on, Father, forgive me. Come on, Father, forgive me. I acknowledge my condition. I change the way I think. Come on, forgive me, Lord, for entertaining those thoughts. Come on, forgive me, Lord, for giving room to the enemy. Forgive me, Lord, for thinking that the enemy has power over me. Forgive me, Lord. Cleanse me with your blood. Come on, in Jesus' name. Come on, I receive your forgiveness. Come on. I receive your forgiveness. I make a decision in Jesus' name. I rise up. I speak to myself. I exercise. Y'all not with me? Y'all are ready to sit down. But I'm going into the year changed and different than when I started. Amen. I renounce every thought that comes up against the knowledge of God. I declare myself free in Jesus' name. Come on, praise team. I declare myself free in Jesus' name. I am free. Somebody say, I am free. I am free. I make a decision today, Jesus, to renew